Thanks very much, Paulie. It's always great to see everybody here and to be able to give you an update today. I'm always a little nervous when I present in front of Paulie because she's always giving me tips on how I should be standing, how I should be presenting, and all these sort of things. So I'm always kind of feeling like I'm a little bit under the gun when I'm here with her. So thanks. Appreciate that. What I'd like to do today is walk you through the Touchstone story and give you really an update. A big part of the focus today is going to be giving you an update on our exploration program, which, to be honest with you, has turned into a little bit of a development program now as we go forward. In the back of the room is James Shipka, who is our Chief Operating Officer. So certainly afterwards, if you want to talk about a bunch of the technical things, please go ahead and talk to James or myself, because we'll be around. So what we really want to talk about today is a couple of different things going on in Trinidad. For those that haven't seen our presentation before, we are dual listed both in Toronto and in London. All of our assets are in Trinidad. Listening to Randy a little bit, I guess we took a little different approach when we listed in London back in June of 2017. We actually raised equity, and since then, any of the equity that we've raised has all been in London. So from our point of view, being an international focus purely in Trinidad, it's been pretty receptive to the market here. And again, something different than the TransGlobe story, we're about probably about 60% retail. We have some institutions, but not a lot. And I guess that also probably reflects our market cap, which has been, it's changed quite a bit in the last 3 weeks, but certainly before that was more sort of a retail focus. So why Trinidad? I think the key thing with Trinidad is Trinidad has actually been in the business of producing hydrocarbons for over 100 years. It's the updip end of the Venezuelan basin. Significant, Gervais at Mighton this morning, who I met with this morning, he described Trinidad as floating on hydrocarbon. I think that's a great expression, but I think it is true when you look at how much oil and gas has been produced and even where it's at currently. You know, eighth largest liquefied natural gas producer in the world, one of the very first that ever came on stream. It's got a multiple industrial users of hydrocarbon, especially natural gas. As I say, it's very close to Venezuela. And it's a great place to do business around the world, certainly in our business, from an environmental and regulatory perspective. So why Touchstone in that whole concept? I think it has a fairly well track record from the management team. This is the third public company that I put together. The previous two were sold off along the way. James ran 28,000 BOE a day, a division of an intermediate in Canada, so certainly he's got the capability to do that. Scott Boudot, who's our CFO, worked at a service company before he came over. And when you look at the technical staff at the next level, they've all worked on a number of big projects, whether that be within Encana or Bellatrix or some of the big players in Canada. Right now, we currently produce between 1,600 and 1,700 barrels of oil in Trinidad. We are positive cash flowing right now. What I'm going to show you is just a massive step change that literally has happened in the last 6 months for the company. And then I'm going to talk about these significant exploration opportunities, which in some cases have now really turned into development opportunities as we go forward. So the five pillars that we have within the company are the exploration upside that I'm going to talk to. What I call the scalable economic growth. That's our development program on the west side of the island where we drill million-dollar oil wells and they pay out basically in 1.8 years. It's a bit of a manufacturing operation and we'll talk about how that's done. The value creation, how that balance is created, what our view is on debt versus equity, how we fund some of these things, and also maybe answer some of the questions that Randy had put in front of him about what's our strategy from a public markets point of view. The fourth is environmental stewardship. We work very hard, especially in Trinidad, to have the highest standards we can environmentally. We've brought some of the best-in-class standards from Canada and other places around the world down to Trinidad, and we're starting to see that pay off. And then on the community side, we like to think that we're a real leader in the communities, but we do it very quietly, and we do it in the areas that we work in. So I'll show you some examples of that towards the end. So this is our land holdings in Trinidad. It's really made up of two separate blocks, if you want to call it that, or types of play. The orange blocks that you see on the west side of the island, that's that manufacturing, that scalable economic growth, million-dollar wells come on at 50 to 100 barrels a day, very repeatable. We can go ahead and do that. Other companies that would be in that same sort of boat would be the Columbuses, the Trinities. Those are our other participants on that part of the island. Then about 5 years ago, we were decided to bid on an onshore bid round, which is that big block you see on the east side of the island, which is called Ortoire. And the idea there was to try to layer on some exploration onto the top of that manufacturing program. You've been hearing me talk about that for 2.5 years. I'm actually going to finally be able to give you some results from there. So excited about that. So let me talk about the exploration upside first of all. So this is that Ortoire block that I just talked about that's on the east side of the island. And really the key here and the challenge that James and myself put out to the technical team was to try to expand on something that had already been found. So back in about the late 1990s, a small Canadian company came in and drilled a couple of wells down. What you can see is those pink pieces down in the bottom, I guess it's left-hand corner of that slide. And it's an area called the Central Block. And there was a number of wells drilled in there that have now been on production. There's only 4 wells actually drilled into the whole pool. It looks like it's going to produce about a half a TCF of gas and about 25 million barrels of oil from about 6,000 feet. Kind of strange that, you know, that's almost an offshore type discovery onshore. Discovered by a small Canadian company, sold to BG. BG got sold to Shell. Shell's now the operator of that. So our challenge to the team was this cannot be the only major gas pool onshore with everything that's going on in Trinidad. So over a period of time, over 3 or 4 years, and especially with low oil prices, gave us a lot of time to focus on some of these things. We went back and looked at the block that we had, and basically there were 70 wells drilled on that block over time in the past from the 1950s to the 1960s. And we tried to look at those old wells in a new light, look at them knowing what we knew about Carrapelle Ridge, know about what we looked at around the world. So what we identified was 4 prospects: Coho, Cascadura, Chinook, and Royston. And the idea was these were wells that were drilled a long time ago, and we thought that they had bypass pay or a misconcept in them the way they had been drilled. So if you look at them, the Coho well was the first well we drilled. It was probably the smallest structure of all the ones that we saw, and it was a gas discovery. If I was standing here a year ago when I gave this presentation, we thought that it would probably be about 8 million cubic feet a day of gas. It turned out that it's about 12 million cubic feet a day of gas. Looks like it's going to come on stream here sort of partway through this year. I'll talk more about it. The second one is Cascadura. A year ago, if I was standing here, I said that was going to be an oil prospect. I'm going to have to apologize to you. It turned out to be a liquids-rich gas prospect that was way bigger than we thought. I'll talk about that in a minute. In April of this year, we'll hopefully move into Chinook, which I still have as an oil prospect, and I hope I have to apologize to you a year from now again on the same thing. And then the last one is Royston, which is actually the biggest of all the prospects. It's a gas prospect drilled back in the 1960s by Shell. We think they've missed a bunch of pay, and we think it looks a lot like the original Carrapelle Ridge. Talk about Coho, first of all. There hadn't been a gas well drilled in Trinidad onshore in about 15 years. So we went ahead, drilled this well, drilled it on budget, about $3 million. And it really, really... in the way we drilled it, we did less damage to the reservoir. The way we tested it, we perforated a more dense section of the reservoir than what they had done when they had tested previously. And you can see that it peaked out at about 20 million cubic feet a day, but a very, very low drawdown. When you test these wells, you actually want to try to draw them down by 50%. Because the way the surface equipment was, there was no way for us to get there. So we're going to bring this well on at 10 to 12 million cubic feet a day, which you can see to us is about 1,300 to 1,600 BOEs a day. So basically doubles the company from where we are today when we bring it on production in July of this year. Again, I remind you, it is the smallest of what we had. The other key thing is economics-wise, a lot of people have asked us gas versus oil on the island. I won't walk you through the whole stack because it's a fairly complicated structure in Trinidad. But basically the royalty on gas is 12.5%. The royalty on oil is 30%. So that's probably the big difference between the two of them when you look at it. So the second well, which was the oil well that we were targeting, and the reason that we anticipated it to be an oil well is that it actually produced the original well back in the 1950s, late 50s, early 60s, had produced about 27,000 barrels of oil. And our concept was pretty simple here, is we thought we could move up structure, get up higher on the structure, but also get into the thicker pay zone of what we were looking for. And to say it turned out better than we thought it would be a little bit of an understatement. We were looking for about 400 feet of pay. We ended up with about 1,000 feet of pay in the well. That's the good news. The bad news is we wanted to drill to 8,000 feet. We had to stop at about 6,400 feet. We had overpressured, and quite frankly, there was a real risk that we were going to lose the well. So we ended up having to stop casing the well and come out. We then went in to test it. We saw oil and lots of oils in the sample. We didn't see any gas, which is very typical of what was going on in the 1950s and 60s, and a lot of reason why we think these wells weren't tested. When you drill them, you have to drill them with fairly heavy mud, so it means you don't get any gas into the wellbore, so it's kind of hard to tell what you've got for gas. So anyway, we went ahead and opened it up, thinking it was going to be an oil well to test it, and very high pressure gas came at us, and I think we tested it for like 90 minutes, James, before we lost our nerve. Everything was kind of frosting up, and it was pretty obvious that it was a different animal than what we thought we had. So we had to move in test equipment, which we moved in. Unfortunately, the only test equipment we can get on the island is capable of about 30 million cubic feet a day of gas. So we basically brought it in, and about a week ago, we opened the well up, and it almost instantaneously went to the 30 million cubic feet a day of gas with about 700 barrels a day of liquids. Give you an idea, that's almost 6,000 BOEs a day of production to us. Again, with a very low drawdown, about a 20% drawdown. In a perfect world, we would have liked to have taken this to a 50% drawdown, but there's just no way to do that with the equipment that we have. The key part of this for us, test for us, is that I talked about there being about 1,000 feet of pay. This is only the lowermost 160 feet that we've perforated. And the reason for that is the way the well was drilled, that was all we could perforate initially. What we'll now do is, a week from Friday, we'll pull the recorders out of the hole, tells us what the bottom hole pressures are. We'll isolate that zone, and we'll go up and perforate 350 feet above it. It's not a separate sand, which is, I think, what a lot of people have thought. It's actually one continuous sand. So what we're going to do is perforate that next 350 feet. I think James and I this morning were asked the question, what do you expect out of that particular zone? I think it'll look a lot like what we had in the lower zone. Again, the problem's going to be is the most we're going to be able to take this to is 30 million cubic feet a day, because that'll be the same equipment that we have. So, theoretically could be another roughly 5,000 BOEs a day in what we're doing. The liquids-rich gas is really the mecca for Trinidad, in that you get lower royalty rates on gas, we get high volumes on gas, and then for the light ends, because there's so much petrochemical business on the island, those really are very, very marketable. Just on the gas side, the island currently produces 3.8 BCF a day of gas. Demand on the island is 4.2, so all the industrials right now are curtailed to about 85%. So there's lots of demand for gas on the island as we go forward. The downside of what this well did for us is it's made us now have to step back, and we're going to have to rethink the entire block, because we were hopefully going to take these two wells to an existing gas plant that had about 35 million a day of capacity. That's not going to be enough capacity for what we have anymore, so we're going to have to figure out how to tie these in. I'll talk about that in a minute, but it's not very far. It's about 3 kilometers to the nearest pipeline. It's just going to mean we're going to have to build some infrastructure. It's a great problem to have, but it is going to take a little longer to get to cash flow. The next well is the Chinook well, hopefully going to move in there in April. It looks a lot like the Cascadero well. We initially risked all of these prospects at 34% chance of success. We are leaving this at 34% chance of success, and the reason for that is it is a different structure. It's never tested hydrocarbon. But it looks, it looks very similar. So hopefully the model that we've proven up in here will hold, and we can go ahead and drill it. Same thing, just going to move up structure where there was hydrocarbon shows while they were drilling it. And I think it's fair to say, James, that this is actually thicker than the original one that we saw in the original well. So we're pretty excited about that. And then following that, we'll move to what we said was the biggest prospect. And it still remains that, to be honest with you. It's a little bit deeper. It's 10,000 feet. So you can pack a lot more gas into the reservoir at that depth. It's called Royston, and it's further to the east. Again, we're offsetting an old well by Shell that was drilled in the 1960s. And to give you a relative possibility of size on this, the Carapel Ridge has about 450 feet of pay. We think in this particular well there's about 700 feet of pay. So gives you, I think, a good idea of what's possibility on what we've got. So we've got a second test going at Cascadura in the next couple of weeks. We've got a follow-up well another exploratory well at Chinook, and then the final well at Royston. What does it all look like? When we started this process, when we started this process, we asked our independent engineer evaluators to look at all four of these prospects and give us an idea of what they thought it would be. Their low estimate was 2,000 BOEs a day. Obviously, we're well beyond that now with the first two wells. Their best estimate was about 8,600 BOEs a day. It looks like that's where we are today with the two wells that we've drilled. With only the lower zone, I think once you add the upper zone, we're going to be somewhere between best estimate and high estimate, and with two additional exploratory wells to drill. And if you look at the MPVs on those, as far as the prospective resources, you know, it's shown about $229 million in value, and the upside here is something in the order of about $650 million. The really interesting thing is we're talking a small number of wells. We're talking four or five wells. So operating costs, G&A, all those other things, like none of that really moves up. All our fixed costs will remain the same. So all of this cash will just fall right to the bottom line, which is pretty exciting. On the development side, I'm not going to touch on this a lot. We've got 19 onshore blocks, 10 producing fields. We've got 208 drilling locations on the development side. These are all medium quality crude, about $1 million wells that come on at somewhere between 50 and 100 barrels a day. We've had some that have come on north of that, but certainly what we see. You can see the curves here. This is really low decline production. It's wonderful stuff. Payouts are 2.1 years at a little higher oil price than where we're at today. Great recycle ratios. And again, we would just see this keep pumping up in what we're doing. It's kind of hard to get excited about this when we're talking about 5,000 BOE a day wells, but these are fundamental. These are good cash flow in what we do. You can see how we've added production. Just below 1,500 barrels a day, we peaked out at about 2,100. But once you start slapping on 5,000 BOE a day wells on top of that, you can kind of see how this curve's going to look very, very different in the next 6 months when Coho comes on, and likely a year from now when Cascadura and hopefully Chinook or Royston come on. So the value creation, we talk about this a little bit. We have a term loan of $20 million Canadian. One of our alternatives to go forward is to expand that term loan. We have that alternative. We're not in a big rush at this point. Don't have any rigs coming in until April, so we're in pretty good shape. We are sitting on some cash as we go forward. And you can see we're positive cash flow at this point. These numbers will look dramatically different a year from now when we see what we've got. The stock price has done exceptionally well. I think that's partly what we've been able to do with on the retail side. Certainly on the proactive side, we use a lot for our interviewing and things like that. I think we've got a really good retail following, and it's been mainly a retail story up till now. I think the next big event is going to be, from a news flow point of view, is going to be that second test at Cascadura, probably in the next month, James. I would say probably a month by the time we have that out. Then we'll move in April to the second well, and move forward from there. Some of the environmental things that we do, we do a lot of stuff that's really around on the green side of things. Some really simple things like recycling on our compound. Believe it or not, there's no recycling in Trinidad. It's a bizarre concept, but some little things we're doing like that to replanting a bunch of the forests on the areas that we're on. We have multiple wells on every pad. We're one of the first operators that drills three or four wells off of every pad that we do, minimizing our footprint. One of the other things that we do is there's any produced water in Trinidad, you can actually let go to the jungle. I can't imagine how many millions of barrels have been released at surface. We are, by the end of this year, we'll have all of our fields will be fully re-injected, so we'll have zero discharge at surface, so really proud of that. It's not something we have to do by regulation, it's just something we think is the right thing to do. On the community side, it's a pretty good crew. There's a great picture of our football team up in the right corner there. You may recognize me. I sort of stand out compared to the rest of the guys there, but if you want to know how to win it at these football matches, you invite all the service companies that you're going to use, Schlumberger, Tucker, all of those, they let you win. It works out really well for us. So we look much better than we are. That's the whole crew down there for our sports day that we do down there. One of the projects really happy with, this is right north of the Cascadura well. It's a school there for special needs kids, and they needed a big addition on it, especially with the influx of people coming from Venezuela. And so we got an old building that was there, and the team redid the old building, and we've got about 40 spaces for special needs kids that it's expanded. It's been a great team builder, great project along the way there. It's my kid in the one picture there. She came down and I put her to work for 2 days. I'm not sure she's going to come back with me again when we come back. But. So this is really the summary. You know, we talk about the significant exploration opportunities. Those have really now turned into development. You know, and standing here, I hope we can be a little bit humble. We would have never expected the success that we've had at Coho and Cascadura. They, you know, to have really had the model prove up the way it is, to be liquids-rich gas at the kind of volumes that we're looking at, it, you know, these are really, I've referred to them as a beast, I think, in one of the casual conversations, but these are really offshore-type prospects onshore in Trinidad. And it's not very often that we get that opportunity. We are going to look at that whole block. It's not just these four prospects. There's going to be follow-ups to the four prospects. There's also other structures that have never been drilled on that particular block that we need to do. There's a lot of hydrocarbons for us to look at there. And the other things that we want to do is we want to do this, you know, as best as we can with some discipline. You can see the balance sheet's pretty clean as we've gone forward. I don't really like borrowing money to drill wells. My history has been they usually turn out dry when you do that. But I am quite happy to borrow money to build facilities, build pipelines, tie in testing, those kind of things. So that's the balance that you'll see coming from us as we go forward. And the big part about it is I think we've made a real change, especially on the environmental side in Trinidad, taking some of those standards down there on the operational side. And it's pretty exciting to see that. And fortunately, we get recognition for that down there as well. So that's the Touchstone story. I think it's going to be great news flow for the next 6 months. And then there's going to be a bunch of cash coming at us towards the end of this year. So it's really exciting, and thanks for everybody being here today.
As you say, the bad news is it's going to take a little bit longer to monetize things, but obviously the monetization will be a lot greater than any of us were expecting, I imagine. Some of us have got the unfortunate, what should I say, the situation that we can't hang around forever. And my investment timeline perhaps wasn't quite as long as it looks like it's going to have to be with this. The market's very bad at the moment, nothing's happening. When do you personally see some sort of life in the share price?
Some sort of life in the share price?
Yeah, I mean, in other words, you're going to have events that the company's doing, you know, operational events. Eventually, there'll be such a discord between the market price and, you know, and what you're doing that's... Are we vulnerable is what I'm really asking. Will something happen because the company's vulnerable to a takeout?
Yeah, a bunch of questions in there. I think, you know, the stock's obviously had some great performance here in the last little while. And that's, you know, I think that's positive. I think there's still a little bit of a wait and see on some of these things, especially, you know, there's been a lot of things go on in our sector this year that we've seen some big rises and some big falls when other results have come out. So I fully understand that. You know, that makes a bunch of sense in what we've done. I think, you know, when you look at the overall value of what that Ortoire block could be worth, I don't know what that is yet. Because it's as I say, it's bigger than I think we expected and what GLJ expected. So it's sort of tough to get up at this point and say, here, you know, here's the potential of this. I think we've got to drill these remaining wells and figure out what we have. As I mentioned, you know, the idea here was we were just going to tie into that gas plant and monetize this over the next 6 months, and away we went. You know, the question we now have is, you know, do we need a 50 million a day gas plant? Do we need a 100 million a day gas plant? Do we need a 150 million a day gas plant? Like there's a whole bunch of questions that we have in here. It is going to take longer to monetize it. And your question's a valid one. At some point here, you know, let's say we end up with a half a TCF or a TCF of gas on that block. You know, is Shell, EOG, BHP, BP, are they going to go, geez, you know, that's really too big for Touchstone. That moves the needle for us in Trinidad. I think that's a very real possibility at some point to have that discussion. But we've got to get it to a level where we get maximum value. And in order to do that, we've got to drill the next prospects as we move forward, for sure. The one real advantage that, you know, we have in Trinidad is they need gas. And the light oil is great for the petrochemical business. And then the third part is, you know, if anybody wants to talk about exit strategy, we've got all the majors there. So if we want to set up a nice auction, you can certainly set that up as you go forward. The other side is if that doesn't happen, the National Gas Company builds pipelines, builds facilities. You have to sell all your gas to them. You know, we had a great meeting with them last week where they want to build all this stuff. So we don't have to tie a bunch of our capital up in to get this stuff on stream. So, it's kind of the best of both worlds for us right now in what we've done. Does the share price reflect the value? I think that's kind of what I hear in the question. I think that I think as a CEO, your answer should always be no. And I certainly feel that way, but I just want to be, we got to be a little bit humble and as I say, this is bigger than what we expected. So I know it's bigger than a bread box, but we're not sure how big it is. So we got to do some more testing to figure that out.
Thank you, Bill.
Thank you. Hi, Paul. The result of Cascadura, which was obviously bigger than expected and so forth, does that have any impact on your perception of risk on the two following on prospect and on their size, given basically you didn't find exactly what you were looking for at Cascadura, it was much bigger.
So the question on reserves at Cascadura, it's obviously bigger than both us and GLJ thought it would be. I think when James and his team get the recorders out of the hole, we'll have a really good idea if there's any boundaries around this thing. That's the good news, like then we'll be able to put some parameters on it. He and I kind of have a side bet. I don't think we're going to see any boundaries on this. Like, I was actually happened to be down there for the test. I don't want anybody to think that I'm the guy that was doing the test. That's not what I do. But I was down there on, I was down there on something else, and we saw no pressure. Like, the pressure drop came back immediately. So, you know, I don't think we are going to see boundaries. I don't think that's going to tell us how big it is. We're going to have to get it on stream, produce it for a while, see how big it is, and then we'll probably have to drill some development wells once we do that. How does it make us feel about the other wells? I think if you were to ask James and I, we feel a lot more comfortable about the next couple of wells with what we've seen here. But because they're individual structures, you've got to drill each one of them. There's no way that we're going to be able to move those into our 2P reserve numbers or something like that. So I think, Stefan, when you, I know I'm, people are trying to nail us down about, you know, reserves and how big these things are. Number one, we got to do the second test. At Cascadura, see if we get similar pressures, see if we get similar liquids to gas ratios, see if we get similar volumes, and then we can probably do some math in what we're doing. But you know, when you're looking for 200 feet of pay and you get 1,000 feet of pay, and when you're looking for, you know, an oil well that's going to be 400 barrels a day and you end up with a liquids-rich gas well that's over 5,000 BOEs a day, this is a whole different animal that than we were looking for sure. But having said that, this isn't unique to the island. Like, if we go back to the original Carapel Ridge well that was drilled, it tested 100 million cubic feet a day and 2 or 3,000 barrels a day, James, I think, in that range. So it's not like this is something that's brand new. It's just nobody had thought that that could be replicated onshore. And, you know, that's now got 15, almost 20 years of production history. So we know what, we've got a model of what this can look like. So this isn't like this is something brand new. It's already been proven up on the island. So again, we feel more comfortable with the risk from that point of view.